Welcome back, students, to this virtual class. So in last class we have already finished the meaning, aims and purpose of directive principles of state policy. So as we all know that directive principles of state policies is like guidelines given to the government in order to formulate future policies. So I guess the general meaning or general definition of directive principles of state policies is understandable to you. So today we will be focusing upon these issues. So scholars have classified the understanding of directive principles of state policy into four categories. They are socialist principle, Gandhian principle, liberal directive principle and general directive principle. So on this class today, on today's class, let's discuss what is socialist principle, and later in subsequent classes we shall discuss what is Gandhian directive principles and liberal directive principles and general directive principle. So what do you mean by socialist directive principle? So in my offline classes I have already discussed about what is socialism, and in your class 11 also I have discussed what is socialism. So this directive principle of state policies, to understand directive state principles of state policies, scholars have divided this principles into four categories. So today let's discuss what is socialist principle. Now, coming to the socialism, what is socialism? Socialism mainly calls for the public ownership. They mainly focus upon the public ownership rather than private ownership or control of property and natural resources. Okay, so under this principle, that is socialist principle or socio-economic principle, these two words can be used interchangeably. So under this socialist principles, there are like many, like 10 principles, but in your examination you can just explain any 6 or any 8. So the most important one are this. It's in your book also. So I'm using the old book and I don't know the page number exactly. In my book the page number is 422. So on that page you can find this principles. So let's discuss this principle one by one. So number one principle: it is a duty of a state to secure welfare of the people by securing socio-economic and political justice. What does this socio-economic or political justice mean? Socio-economic and political. So in this means that a state, like state should put, it is like that people should be socially included, economically benefited and politically justified. So in my subsequent classes, in my offline classes also, I have clearly mentioned the meaning also. Kindly turn to that page and recapitulate it. If I go on summing up these points like socio-economic and political, it will be very huge, like large video, so it will be very difficult for me to send. Now let's coming to the other part, is that state should provide adequate means of livelihood to all citizens. So what does this livelihood means? Livelihood particularly deals with three important topics, that food, clothing and shelter. So every Indian citizen must that government should provide food, clothing and shelter, and it must be provided. Like educated youth should get jobs, and if the population is not educated, then also government should formulate certain policies to absorb that uneducated youth in terms of securing their livelihood. If a person earns a certain number of wages, a certain number of salary, he or she can well define his food, shelter and clothing for him or for her, as well as their family also. So number third principle, state should try to secure equitable distribution of materials, resources, and promote common good. So what does this equitable distribution of material resources mean? Wealth of a country should be equally distributed, and that can that equal distribution of wealth can be reached to the masses on a grassroots level also. So in order that not to arise any chaotic situation, the government has to fulfill the basic amenities of the people who are like who can't they have an incapacity. Like in this pandemic, we are like the middle class of people, like rich high class people are there, but we can't ignore those kind of persons who earn their living in a daily wages, a daily worker. So in this kind of situation, like in this pandemic, what our government is doing that they are sending basic amenities to them. So this not just only occurs in a pandemic situation, it occurs every time. So the wealth of a nation, like the from rich people, the taxes are collected, and taxes are slowly converted by the government to give certain sustenance, free LPG subsidies, free rice subsidies to the general people or poor people. So this equitable distribution of material resources is for the promotion of common good. Common good means for the people, the general people who resides particular in that state or in that particular country. So now let's focus upon the next principle. States should prevent from concentration of wealth and the means of production in few hands. So in this principle, it is divided into concentration of wealth and means of production in few hands. It simply says that if a means of, if this concentration of wealth is in particular in one single person, then what happens? It is a duty of a government to see that the wealth of this wealth does not concentrate in the hands of very few people. Otherwise, what it will become, that rich will become richer and richer, whereas poor will become poorer and poorer, and it affects the general development of a country. We India do follow a socialism principles, and whenever you write this kind of principles, you need to think about the topic is socialism. So socialism always formulates or goes for the public ownership, not for private ownership. So then the next point is means of production in few. So what does this means of production means? Under means of production, there are land, labor, capital, and organization. In economic class, you have I guess you have studied about this four things, that is land, labor, capital, and organization. So these things, land, labor, capital, and organization, should be controlled by state government, not by private government, private property holder. This should be given, this should be in the case for everything, because if it generates employment opportunities for the people, so from the low class people and the upper class of people can apply for that particular post and sustain their livelihood. So if a wealth is concentrated to the single hand, rich will become richer and poor will become poorer. So if the means of production is controlled by few people, that will lead to unemployment and many other issues that will be very nuisance for our state and for the people who sustains their life by earning a daily wage. So now let's go for this one, equal pay for equal work. I know every now and then this topic has been highlighted in the news also. So what does this equal pay and equal work mean? This is related to both men and women, not just just that men should be like men do their work very very rigorously, so men should be provided more money than women. But this principle totally says that the work done by either male or female should be given equal wage. So this is like in private companies also and public companies also, this principle is going on. And now in India we get equal pay. So now let's go to the sixth, like this one is sixth principle, protect health and strength of a worker. So this means that in a country there is a population and we require workforce to sustain our economy, whether it be in institution, whether it be in industries, whether it be in private companies, everything is like run by humans. Like, so in order to run our companies or run certain things smoothly, a government should make a check and balance or have a record of keeping the health of their workers in a positive manner. So how a government can protect the health of the workers? By establishing dispensaries or hospitals to them and giving such kind of insurances so that they can so the health of a population or a health of a workers is protected. Now let's go for the seventh. The state should protect children from any harmful work. So this is a very debatable topic now and then. So Indian Constitution has strictly formulated in this socialist principle that children should be protected from any harmful work. So if a children is at his age, like Right to Education Act is also passed, and every children from KG level to like certain age, like 14 years of an age, should have a right to take an education without free and compulsory education. But in certain parts of India, in certain sectors, we see that the children are sent to work in industries like chemical industries, like so many things. So that is very much avoided. So state strictly formulate certain policies to guide the security of these children. So it is very like it is we say that we can say that it is not good to say send small children to work in industries or any harmful work, hazardous work. Okay, so now let's go to the eighth point, that is state should protect children and youth from exploitation. Children and youth from exploitation, so that if a person for a certain age are sent to work on certain things, like exploitation can be of numerous factors, whereas girls are exploited, boys are also exploited, children are also exploited. So in a state, the government looks after that. It creates certain policies that the children are not exploited. So this is about socialist principles or directive principles. So in your book there is in a detail account, you have to make your notes by yourself. So this becomes your socialist principle. So in next class I'll be dealing like Gandhian principles, liberal democratic principles and general principles. So from that I guess the direct principles of state policies will be like covered. So I want you to complete your work and send me your this notes, so that I can gauge that how many students have understood the points or certain important things. So in our Google Meet we will just talk about what are the issues that you are facing. Okay, till then stay safe.